أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه الحمد لله الذي هدانا لهذا وما كنا لنهتدي لولا أن هدانا الله الحمد لله على نعمة الإسلام الحمد لله على نعمة التوحيد الحمد لله الذي أتم النعمة وأكمل الدين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين سيد الأولين والآخرين سيدنا محمد وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين وعلى الصحابة أجمعين وعلى التابعين وتابعيهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين اللهم واجعلنا منهم يا رب العالمين أبدأ I start in the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala most gracious most merciful let me share with you something that I have seen on the YouTube, something that really disturbed me, because it tells us that there are people out there who are active undoing what we are doing, basically. And I mean, they have every right to do so. Everybody is supposed to promote their ideas. Everybody is supposed to try to proselytize, as it were, you know, their religion and their creed. But what I didn't like about it is to use somebody's need, you know, in order to pressure them when it comes to their religious persuasion. This was a YouTube that was recorded from a charity that belongs to a church, with a priest who is a convert. He was a Muslim and he converted to Christianity. He's Moroccan. And an Iraqi girl, Kurdish girl, again, apparently she was Muslim and she converted to Christianity. And they were trying to help a Muslim convert, a Muslim lady. Apparently she's a convert, she was Christian and she converted to Islam. And somehow she's going through tough times. So she went to that charity in order to ask for help. They're showing their shelf, you know, their shelves stocked with cans of food and, you know, rice and milk and things like that. The reason why I'm telling you this is that that priest knew exactly which nerve to hit. He knew that the one who was in front of him is a woman. And he started to talk to her as a woman. Do you know that your husband can marry another three wives in addition to you? And she told him, I know that. Do you know that in addition, he can have as many concubines and slave girls, you know, as he, you know, he can buy or he can own and so on. Of course, she stood firm. Apparently, she's educated in Islam because she said, I used to attend Islamic halakas and Islamic classes at the masjid. And apparently, her husband also is somehow an imam or a religious person, because she was saying, he told me this and that. The point is, it seems to me that they know exactly the psychology, or that person knew exactly the psychology of the woman, and he wanted to use that, you know, as a window of opportunity for him to try to bring her back to Christianity. Of course, he did not succeed. Why I am telling you this? I am telling you this, brothers and sisters, because last Friday, after I gave my class, I was expecting, after the session was over, that I'm going to get some protests from the brothers, because basically I was saying that the, you know, there is a lot of abuse, you know, going on, and that the overwhelming majority of the abuse is practiced by men, you know, on women, you know, and I was defending women. I was explaining that in most of the cases they are the victims. But it seems some misunderstood me, some sisters misunderstood me when I said that there are some problems also on the side of the, don't think that, you know, that means that women do not have problems somehow. And I said that the major problems that men complain about is nushuz. And nushuz is a term, it means disobedience or stubbornness. It is mentioned in the Quran and is mentioned in the hadith. And I talked about it in light of the ayah and in light of the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Brother Radwan showed me after I went to him, he sent by phone to me some of the comments, you know, of some of the sisters. They apparently did not like that. One saying, I am leaving the session and this is my last time I'll be here. One saying, you are accusing us women of being stubborn. That is not, you know, that is not right. One saying that I've been married to a Muslim who performed Hajj three times or Umrah three times. I don't remember Hajj or Umrah. I think it's Hajj, you know, three times, but still all the men are the same. And statements like this. That's why I made the title of this session today, Gender Relations Accepting Allah's Judgment. You see, brothers and sisters, we live in a society that makes its own laws. All the laws here of the land are man-made. And that's why people keep voting and Congress keeps changing and altering, you know, these laws. And the way to reform laws here and to amend laws here is basically to campaign against a certain law or a certain regulation. When that happens, pressure is applied on the lawmaker, and as a result of that, he gives, you know, some concession. So let's say the senior citizens want to have more rights, for example. They form a group. That group starts protesting and starts contacting politicians and congressmen and, you know, lawmakers and applying pressure on them so that they can get more, you know, a bigger slice of the cake, as it were. Same thing with other groups, you know, that try to, veterans, for example, of war, foreign wars, teachers, women liberation groups, you know, homosexuals, all of those form these pressure groups, if you will, or lobbying, and they try to apply pressure so that they can get more. This is not the case in our religion. Our religion is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not sexist. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not a male, nor is he is a female. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala issues laws, he issues laws for the best of our interest, because he is our creator. He says, أَلَا يَعْلَمُ مَنْ خَلَقُ وَهُوَ اللَّطِيفُ الْخَبِيرُ. Doesn't he know his creation? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is all knowing. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala issues a law, that law is for us to apply, not to alter, not to play with, not to say, well, I don't like this, maybe I can change it, or I can form a group, or I can protest. And, you know, as if you are a customer in a shop and you're threatening not to come back. And if you do not come back, somehow the store owner is going to change his policy. It's not like that, you know, in our religion. In our religion, the very meaning of Islam, the very meaning of Islam is to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Islam means submission. To submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. By your Lord, they will never be believers. حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ. Until they come to you in judgment, in all of their affairs. Not only that, ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ. And they will not have or find any resistance in their hearts to your judgment. وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا and totally accept it. That is the judgment of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allows a Muslim man to marry four women, that is for the best interest of the man, and that is for the best interest of the woman. I'm not saying that this is a good thing that should be done, but it is allowed. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has allowed it. I know it is illegal, you know, in this country, but religiously, Islam allows to marry more than one woman, up to four, that is. And what that priest was trying to do is to play, because he knows that we live in this culture that puts man as God, and everything is supposed to serve man and follow the desires of man, including religion. That is why he was trying to influence her using this kind of logic. See, Islam allows your husband to marry three more women in addition, you know, in addition to you. He knows that as a woman living in this culture, she's not going to like that. Again, I believe those sisters, that two or three sisters that sent their comments last time Again, it seems that they are thinking along the same lines. Nushuz is a hukum shari. That is the disobedience of the wife to her husband. It is mentioned in the Quran. وَاللَّائِي تَخَافُونَ نُشُوزَهُنَّ فَعِظُوهُنَّ. Those that become disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to their husbands. I am sorry. And the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam says, لَا طِيرَةَ إِلَّا فِي ثَلَاثٍ. Like I told you last week, that there is no pessimism except when it comes to three things. One of them, the disobedience of the wife to her husband. These are real issues and these are real, you know, problems. We cannot just pretend, you know, that they do not exist. You see, I call this series Real Issues because I want to change the understanding of many of us of what religion is and what is the purpose of religion. In the minds of many people, religion is about spirituality, talking about spiritual things and enjoying you're having a good spiritual time and enjoying it spiritually. And that's it. There is nothing, you know, beyond that. And again, this is an influence of the culture that we live in, because the culture that we live in considers religion a personal spiritual relationship with God. You go to church here in this country in order to have a good time, spiritual time, to enjoy your time, to feel good about yourself and to feel that you are forgiven your sins. Islam is different. Islam is a way of life, and Islam deals with our real issues. I am pretty sure if I dedicate this series to the story of Prophet Musa alayhi salam or Prophet Nuh, we will not have any different opinions, and everybody will enjoy it, and everybody will be, you know, will be happy. But once we start dealing with reality and dealing with the real issues, here, you know, is the real test, and here where we are supposed to discuss these free from any biases, because this is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I'm not telling you my personal opinions. If I tell you my personal opinions, I would be the first one to condemn myself, you know, if I say something wrong. But if I'm saying ahkam, laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those are the laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is our, you know, deen. That reminds me again, more than 30 years ago, maybe 35 years ago, I gave a lecture in a masjid in Chicago. It was about the penal system in Islam, you know, the penalties in Islam. So I gave my lecture. I defined what a crime is according to the Islamic jurisprudence, and then the different kinds of walls that Islam builds between a person and committing a crime. And one of those walls and barriers is the penalty that a criminal is supposed to receive in Islam. Then I talk the different classes of penalties, the hudud and the ta'zir and the qasas and, you know, ta'zir, all of that. At the end of the, and of course I was saying ayahs and hadith, and I did not give any personal opinion. I was basically telling them that the had of zina is such and such, the had of qadf, falsely accusing somebody, is such and such, the had of thift is such and such, and so on. After I finished, a brother came to me and he told me, brother, I did not come to the masjid to hear a legal, you know, lecture. You are a lawyer, you're not a sheikh. I told him, what do you mean I'm a lawyer, I'm a sheikh? I was reciting ayahs and telling you a hadith. He said, no, but you're talking about legality and you know, evidence and things like this. These are the terms and things that the lawyers... I told him that's exactly what Islam is. Islam contains ahkam that deal with real life situations. What did you want me to talk about? He said, well, you should be talking about good morals, honesty, how to be nice, how to be compassionate. And I told him, brother, you never entered into real Islam. Whoever brought you into Islam apparently did not explain to you what you are getting into. You are supposed to understand that Islam is a way of life. And part of it is that there is a complete code of law that is supposed to govern all of the activities of us as individuals and as a society as well. And as a Muslim, you're supposed to believe in these ahkam and to believe in these judgments from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And it seems, again, like I told you, there are many Muslims that will feel hesitant, for example, to say that in Islam, a thief should have his hand severed. But that is a hukum. That is the hukum, the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, if there are certain conditions and requirements that are supposed to be met, that has to do with the thief himself, with the theft, how it happened, and with whatever they have stolen. But eventually, if it is proven that it is a theft, that is the penalty in Islam for theft, to have the hand, the right hand of the thief severed. This is an ayah in the Quran. I know that nowadays we have, again, those people who bow to pressure when people starting protesting and saying, oh, this is not this cruel, this is this and that. So they start saying cutting hands off means to keep people away from stealing. It does not mean physically. That is not true. It means physically severing the hand. That's what the Prophet والسلام, has done, and that is what the Sahaba and the Khulafa of the Prophet والسلام, have done. So to be a Muslim means to submit your will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when it comes to two things. First, to accept Allah's universal judgment, which means He created you a male. You have to accept that. Or He created you a female. You have to accept that. You were born in a certain time. You have to accept that. You have born in a certain culture. You have to accept that. These are things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you. This is part of your destiny. This is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided for you. Most of the problems happen when people do not accept what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. Take homosexuality that we talked about, for example, last time. You know, nowadays there is an uproar in Egypt because there are two major events that are, or issues that are going on. First, there is a lesbian Egyptian girl. She migrated to Canada a few years back because, like she says, she has a lot of pressure, you know, on her in Egypt. And a week ago or 2 weeks, she committed suicide, you know, in Canada, leaving a letter saying that nobody understands here and, you know, that this is too much for her. And then also there is the daughter of an actor, a famous actor over there, who changed her gender to become a boy. She was a girl and she took hormones or, you know, some medical procedures to become a boy. Her father went on the news and he said it is because there is an imbalance in her chemical being or in her chemistry. Later on, so nobody protested or nobody complained. Later on, that boy, who was a girl, went on, you know, on the social media and said, no, I did not have any chemical imbalances. I was a perfect girl, but I had some homosexual tendencies and I wanted to become a boy. And that's what I did. Somebody went and sued him or sued her for trying to spread homosexuality, which is apparently illegal, you know, in Egypt. And people were involved in this social media battle where some are for and some are against. But my point is, both of them are saying that we did not accept Allah's judgment when it comes to who we are or what our identity. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you as a girl and or created you as a male. And that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's universal judgment, you know, regarding you. If you go against it, usually all you are going to get is misery and hardship. And having this eternal conflict inside, you know, inside of you, between what you are, you know, in reality, and what you are trying to convince yourself that you are, or that you are supposed to be. Accepting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judgment is the way for peace, eternal peace. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you a certain rizq, provision, whatever Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you, that is what He decided. He makes people super rich, some people super rich. These people are not more intelligent than you. You might be way more intelligent than them. They are not more hardworking than you. You might put more hours and more hard work than they do. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala somehow has decided that they will have this much and that you are going to have this much. Now you have two options. Either you accept that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, does not mean that you become lazy, you continue to work, but whatever you get, you say, alhamdulillah, this is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I accept that. Or you reject it. You say, I deserve more, I should have, you know, more than this, why this person have more than me? And you become an envious person who has grudges against other people, and you will suffer inside of you, because in the end you are not going to get more than what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided for you anyways. So accepting Allah's judgment when it comes to our destiny and what we have is the way for internal peace and the way for happiness in this life. The second kind of submission and acceptance, in addition to the universal judgment or the qadr, the qada of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala judgment when it comes to the rulings. He says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَن يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not up to a believing man, nor up to a believing woman. Once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides on an issue, that they should have a choice. Once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decides on an issue, it means you do not have a choice regarding that issue. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, alcohol is forbidden. What does that mean? I have a choice to drink or not to drink? No. Before I did. Now, after Allah has decided on this issue, it means as a believer, I must submit to the ruling of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Take the example of hijab. When the ayah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to his messenger, وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُرِهِنَّ عَلَى جِيُوبِهِنَّ, let them use their head cover in order to cover their bosoms, the upper part of the chest, around the neck. All the Muslim sahabiyat, the companions of the Prophet, the female companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, they rushed to cut pieces, you know, of cloth and to wrap them around their heads. The reporter of the hadith says, next morning in the Fajr prayer, women came to the masjid looking like ravens with rags on their heads. Exactly, the hadith says, like ravens, you know, the black bird. Now, these Muslim women, those companions of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, did not say, wait a minute, let me look for something pretty. You know, let me wait a week, for example, to take my time to pick up a nice color. Well, let me decide whether this looks nice or, you know, I look pretty in it. They did not think about that. All they thought about is that this is an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have to fulfill, period. Regardless of anything else, regardless of what people will say, regardless of how I am going to look in the eyes, you know, of other people. This is an order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Again, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to, ordered the Muslims to stop drinking alcohol, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ. That alcohol, gambling, and ansab, that is like lottery, are from the work of shaitan. So avoid them if you want to be successful. You know what happened? Those who used to drink for 20 years, 30 years, 40 years, alcoholics, they got their alcohol from their homes. The jars, the hadith says, that they have of alcohol. And they poured it in the streets of Medina. You know, these narrow paths that they have in Medina, until it was running in some places like a little river. They did not say, wait a minute, let's go back to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Maybe he can give us a break. Maybe we can influence him, you know, somehow, and he can allow us another month, for example, in order to take our time and prepare ourselves psychologically, you know, to do that. No, they did not think like that. Why? Because they were true believers. And a true believer, like I said, means a one who accepts, who submits his will to the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us that nushuz or disobedience of the wife to her husband is a sin and is haram, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala comes up with a process, you know, to deal with that, we have to accept that from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, like I said, is not issuing this law as a male or as a female. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is, you know, above gender. I just wanted to clarify this issue and to make the idea abundant of what is halal, of what is a Muslim, or how a Muslim thinks. A Muslim does not think, well, let me show some protest and maybe we can get some concessions, or maybe we can change this this hukum. Changing the ahkam of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a major sin that amounts to kufr, because you are falsifying the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَفْتَرُونَ عَلَى اللَّهِ الْكَذِبِ لَا يُفْلِحُونَ. Those who alter the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will never be successful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if there is a hukum, there is a hukum. This is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, people might not like it, like that hukum. It doesn't mean that we have to alter it in order for people to like it. Allah says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُ شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. You might dislike something, but the reality of it is that it is good for you. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. وَاللَّهُ يَعْلَمُ وَأَنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And you might like something, and it is bad for you. It is harmful for you, because it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who knows the reality, you know, of things. We do not know the reality of things as human beings. And look at man-made laws. People keep changing them. You know, every 10, 15 years, they make an amendment. Then they amend the amendment. Then they amend the amendment of the amendment. And finally, they cancel the whole law and they come up with a new law. What does that mean? What was wrong yesterday might be good and acceptable today. And what is good and acceptable today might become a crime. You know, after people live according to different standards, there is no consistency. In the religion of Islam, the hukum of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is universal. It is applied to everybody, men, women, old, new, in this place or in that place. Halal Muhammadin, halal ila yawm al-qiyamah. What Muhammad deems as allowed and acceptable is allowed and acceptable until the day of judgment. And whatever he deems as prohibited and wrong and haram is haram anywhere. There are some people who try to localize Islam. They're coming up with what they call European Islam or westernized Western Islam. There's no such a thing. Islam is one. And the rule of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. There is no Arabic Islam and Turkish Islam and, you know, Indonesian Islam. Even though there are attempts, you know, by the enemies of Islam to create such divisions and chaos, you know, among the Muslims. But whether you are living in Paris or New York or in Mecca or in Dhaka or in Lahore or, you know, in Nouakchott or any place on the earth, the code of laws is supposed to be the same, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with the issues as human issues, regardless of the person or the time that this person lives in, or the place that that person lives in. The laws of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are human because they apply to the human being as a human being, not because he's a human being who lives in this country or in that country, or because he is male or because he is female or because he is, unless there are certain laws that are deal specifically with situations that deal with our gender. For example, should a woman who's pregnant fast or not? You cannot apply the same rule to the man, because the man doesn't get pregnant. So this hukum deals with a specific situation that applies to a certain reality. Other than that, you do not say should a woman pray or not, because that is for both men and women. All the ahkam of Islam are supposed to be like that. There is no Islam for the Arabs and Islam for, you know, the non-Arabs. Islam for converts and Islam for those who were born as Muslims. I just wanted to clarify this issue, because like I said, we live in a culture, I think I mentioned that in the first class of this series, that is based on humanism. And humanism basically means that man is the center of the universe. He is the one to be served. God has to serve him. You know, God has to say things and issue laws that are pleasing to man. If that is the case, then God is not God. Now we are God then. And that is exactly what I told you. One of the famous nuns who turned an atheist started her book, you know, with the statement, in the beginning, man created God. To her, it's the other way around. It's man who created God. So God is supposed to be subservient to our human desires. He should say things that are nice to us. He should not say or order or do things that we consider wrong, as if we are the ones who have the total wisdom and not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the wise, and he is Hakim, he is Alim, he is Khabir. Those are the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we believe in. That's why we trust his judgment and we accept his judgment. So somebody tells you, sisters, Islam allows men to marry more than one, and he does not allow you to do that. Tell them that is the truth, and that is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said, and that is the true thing that should happen. That is the best thing for both the man and the woman, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. When they tell you Allah in inheritance, in some cases, he gives the male double what he gives to the female. That is what is fair, and that is what is just, because it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, you do not have to take these laws out of their context. You have to put them in their perspective. In Islam, for example, the one who is responsible for the nafaqa of the woman is always a man. A woman never has to work. All of her life, she has guaranteed social security, as it were, from the moment that she is born until the moment that she dies. She is the responsibility of some man, her father, her husband, her son, her brother. But when they try to use these things in order to make Islam look unjust to you, or look as something that needs to be altered, or something that needs to be changed, or something that needs to be left. Because that's exactly what the priest I told you about in the YouTube was trying to do. He was trying to convince that sister, you know, to go back to what she was before, to go back to Christianity and to abandon Islam. طيب, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to guide us, to guide our both our brothers and our sisters to accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's judgment, whether it is a universal judgment that has to do with who we are and where we were born and our background, the colors that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us, the lifespan that we live, you know, the difficulties that we go through, and also to accept Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's ahkam and to help us apply them to the best of our ability. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, إِذَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِأَمْرٍ فَأْتُوا مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. If I order you or I tell you to do something, do it to the best of your ability. And that is, as Muslims, what we are supposed to be doing. Let me stop here and see if you have any comments or any issues to clarify. I wish that the sister who said I'm going to leave the session stayed and, you know, expressed her opinion. Maybe we can answer some of the concerns or some of the questions that she has, or somebody else who's convinced of her point of opinion. Like I told you, this is not your typical sheikh giving a typical class. You know, I do not want you just to listen and be at the receiving end. I want you to think, and I want you to discuss ideas, and I want you to apply that to your reality that you live in, to come up with ideas and to generate issues and questions for us to deal with. طيب, barakallah feekum. I'll stop here and see if you have any comment or you have any questions. You can go ahead, either unmute yourself if you want to ask it directly by voice, or you can write it. Inshallah ta'ala, let me see if I can see. I can't find the... Okay, here is the chat. All right, I got some questions here. Assalamu alaikum. Okay, no questions so far from the participants. Okay, you have any questions, brothers, or any comments about what I have said? Feel free to ask whatever you want to ask. That's why I usually divide the session into two halves, almost about 30 minutes. I talk about the topic that I want to talk about, and I leave another 30 or so minutes in order to give you time in order to discuss things and to ask questions. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. I know this may be off topic, but given the political climate nowadays, should Muslims now get involved in the political process and make their voice heard. This is a big subject. It's not our subject. If you want, we can make it a topic of a session where we can discuss, you know, political participation, you know, of Muslims, what it means, what is allowed and what is not allowed, and if it is allowed, what is the proper way of doing it. But this is not our our topic. Type other questions that you have or other issues. I don't like to change, you know, the topic. What is the best way to say to someone when they do not wear or remove their hijab? Tell them to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is a hukum. The hijab is a hukum, is a rule from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is not something that is up to us. You know, it is not up to men or to women, you know, to agree with it or to disagree with it. This is a hukum from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by the way, the hijab is mentioned in the Quran, and it consists of two pieces that should, both of them are required to be worn by Muslim women. First, the jilbab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ya ayyuhan nabiyyu kull li nisa'ika wa nisa'i al-mu'minin yudlina yudnina alayhinna min jalabibihin. Tell your wives and the wives of the believers, or the women folks of the believers, to draw their jilbabs closer to them, not to open it, that is. The jilbab is a loose fitting garment that is supposed to be worn on top of the regular clothes. So if a woman is wearing a skirt, for example, and a blouse, or a dress, or pants and a shirt, or something like that, they are supposed to wear on top of it a loose-fitting garment that is called jilbab. In some countries, they call it abaya. And some in Iran, for example, they call it the shadur. Okay, but whatever it is, it's a loose-fitting garment that is supposed to be worn on top of the regular clothes. It's not supposed to be transparent. That is supposed to be thick. It is not supposed to be tight. That describes the features of the body. This is the first, and should not be an imitation of the non-believers, like the garments of the nun, for example, that the nun wears. It should not attract the attention either. It should not be decorated so that it will attract the attention. The second piece is the ayah I mentioned to you, يُدْنِينَ عَلَيْهِنَّ وَلْيَضْرِبْنَ بِخُمُورِهِنَّ عَلَى جِيُوبِهِنَّ. Let them cover or use their head cover to cover their upper chest or their bosoms. This, the second piece is called hijab. And hijab is the piece of cloth that a woman is supposed to wear on her head and is supposed to cover all of her head, including the ears, including the neck. The only thing that is she allowed to show is the face. And the face is from the beginning of the hair on top of the forehead until the chin, and from the stud of this ear to the stud of this ear. That is called the face. She's allowed to show that. Other than that, it has to be covered. That is the Islamic hijab. And the hukum of it is that it's a wajib, or it's a fard on the Muslim woman. Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he saw a girl apparently reaching the age of puberty and she was not covered. And he said in the mar'ata idha arakat, that a girl, once she reaches the age of puberty, should cover all of her body except this and this. He pointed to his hands and to his face. So the hukum is that it is a fard, and it is it is obligatory. This is in public. This is when a Muslim woman goes out, you know, in public or in front of men who are not, you know, close family, like a brother or a husband or, you know, a father. But that is the hukum of the hijab. Quickly, so if somebody is not wearing it, remind them of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Somebody says nowadays it's a fashion event. Yes, unfortunately. Nowadays, some women have turned their head covering into fashion. And they put all kind of makeup and they draw their faces as if it is a picture. And then they wear a decorated head cover and decorated dresses. And they put perfume on and they go outside and they say that we are committed to hijab. That is not hijab. All of these things are haram. you know, to use the perfume, the decoration that attract the attention, and all of that. طيب, assalamu alaikum, can you elaborate? I keep missing, because it keeps going up. طيب, assalamu alaikum, can you elaborate what it means when a wife isn't being obedient? I know you mentioned it earlier, very briefly. As someone that is fairly new to Islam, I do not want to misunderstand what that means under the context of Islam. طيب, according to our religion, the wife is supposed to obey her husband in things that are not haram, in things that are not prohibited. That is the right of the husband. And I told you the hadith of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, إن المرأة إذا صلت خمسها وأطاعت زوجها وحفظت فرجها يعني فقد وجبت لها الجنة. Once a woman prays her five prayers and obey her husband and keeps her chastity, then that is her way or her path to paradise. It is obligatory, that is, on the woman, on the husband, I'm sorry, on the wife, to obey her husband in things that pertain to him, not in public matters. It doesn't mean to obey your husband if he tells you, for example, I want you to vote for this candidate, that you have to listen to him. Because this is not a part of the marriage life. This is not part of the domestic affairs. This is something that you decide on. Or if he tells you that you should study engineering rather than medicine, for example, you are the one who's supposed to decide that, not your husband. I mean, he can give you his opinion if he wants to, and you can accept it if you want to. But it is not. This is not the domain where you listen to your husband. But for example, if you want to fast on a Thursday, because it is the sunnah to fast on a Thursday, and your husband tells you not to fast, you have to obey him. You cannot fast in that case. If he tells you to do something that has to do with the domestic life, for example, and you refuse to do it, your married life, within the family, and you refuse to do that, you know, your child is crying and he tells you to pick it up, to pick him up or to pick her up, and you refuse to do that, that is disobedient. That is nushuz. That is what I called stubbornness last time. It's I think the word stubbornness might not be the right choice of words, and maybe that's why there has been some misunderstanding. What I meant is to disobey her husband when he tells her to do something within his authority. That is the meaning of nushuz. Like I said, it is haram. This means the wife here is committing a sin when she does that. And I said that most of the cases, when it has to do to the wife being the reason, I'm not saying most of the cases or most of the women are like that. But whenever I counsel people usually, and I deal with problems all the time, most of the problems that have to do with the woman come from this issue, the issue of disobedience of the wife to her husband, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his messenger called nushuz. طيب, I hope that is that issue is clear, the obedience of the husband. What circumstances are men allowed to marry more than one woman? The only circumstance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put in the ayah is that, well, first, if they are able to, apparently, and second, if they are just, if they know that they can be just, if they know that they can be fair, you know, to all of them. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا فَوَاحِدًا. If you think that you cannot be fair, you cannot be just, then you should not marry more than one. Other than that, it is allowed. Barakallah fiqh. طيب. Again, it doesn't mean that I am telling people, if you ask me personally, if I like to marry more than one, I will tell you one is more than enough. You know, my personal opinion. There is a difference. You see, we have to understand this idea. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that something is allowed, it doesn't mean that automatically it should be done. It just means that there are certain circumstances that you have to decide, you know, where it makes sense for you to do that. What are these circumstances? Each one is different. Maybe somebody wants children and his wife is barren, for example. She cannot get pregnant and he doesn't want, he loves her, he doesn't want to divorce her. Okay, so he marries another one for that purpose. This is just an example. Okay, but the main point is that when it comes to the legality of it, something being allowed, you are allowed to eat gyros. Does that mean you eat it? I'm allowed to eat sugar and candy, but I don't eat it because I am diabetic. It doesn't mean if something is allowed, you have to do it. You have to decide what is fitting for you, what is, you know, good for you. And in this case, what is good for the other people. What is good for your first wife, for example, if that's going to cause her harm or distress or not, you know, and what is good also for the new one, and whether you are going to be fair to both of them or not. طيب. If the husband asks the wife to pick up the baby and she doesn't want to because she is tired or she doesn't want to do the dishes, is that considered disobedience? Yes, that is considered disobedience because that is within the domestic family life. If she cannot, she cannot. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. So if she is very tired and she cannot do it, he is supposed to pick up the child, the baby, and he is supposed to help her. He cannot ask her more than what she can do. But if she can do it and she refuses because she doesn't like it or she doesn't want to, in that case, it is haram. Now, regarding the doing the dishes, I think I explained that to you when somebody asked me, I think it's not the last session, maybe the session before that, about the right of the husband and whether he has any more rights other than the sexual enjoyment, basically, because that is what some scholars say. I said that the urf, what is known as the urf, and what is known as the ishra, the marriage life as it is known and defined by the society, is part of the ahkam. And by urf, usually the man is the one who goes outside the home and the house, and he is the one who protects, and he is the one who provides, and the wife usually takes care of the domestic affairs. Again, apparently some sister did not like that and said that's like being a maid or being a servant, and you know, we do not want to be a servant. They do not know that some of the greatest successful women, you know, in Islam, I'm not talking about the past, by the way, I'm talking about now. You can find scientist women who work in the most developed research centers. They are Muslim, they are covered, and they are married, you know. And still they do their home chores exactly like any other wife. Don't think that just because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you a role that you cannot do other things, or that you have to become a servant, like you say, and not, you know, pursue your career if you want to, or your education if you want to. But ultimately, at least to me, this is a personal opinion, I think the most important role that a woman can do is being a mother. Being a mother is the most honorable and most the greatest, if you will, you know, role that a woman can play. This is my personal opinion. You know, you don't have to agree with it. She can still be a teacher, you know, or pursue her career. But being a mother, to me, is the most important career. طيب, other questions then regarding this matter, accepting the judgment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alhamdulillah, today we have a brother who declared his Islam. I don't know if he's with us or not, but that is Brother Alec. Brother Alec has, alhamdulillah, declared his Islam today after Jumu'ah. Subhanallah, we had four people last Friday and this Friday who declared their Islam. All of them are they're young, they're in their 20s, early 20s. Alhamdulillah. طيب, please announce the next topic before closing. I do not know what the next topic you want me to discuss to be about. We have issues that have to do with the youth. If you want me to go into that direction, there is the danger of atheism out there. there is the I don't think that it's a phenomenon of Muslims leaving Islam or becoming Christian. I gave you the example of this YouTube video that I saw. It doesn't mean that Muslims are flocking to Christianity. A Muslim becoming a Christian is a very, very rare happening. The other way, Christians becoming Muslim is way more, you know, common than that. I don't think that we need to dedicate much time, you know, to that. But there is a danger of our young men and women, those who are teenagers at an age when they are rebellious. Some of them might get affected of the Darwinism or atheism or, you know, things like that. If you want, we can discuss that. If you want, we can discuss the internet and the dangers of the internet. There are a lot of problems also that are happening because of the internet. We have people joining groups, you know, and those, in the beginning, there might be innocent discussions and things like that. But later on, your child, your son, your daughter might find themselves victims of a well-organized cult or group that are promoting certain ideas. There are the games, you know, the video games and online games and things like that, that promote, drugs or promote crime or things like that. So if you want, we can discuss the internet and the dangers of the internet. If you want, another topic is to talk about our community and how to build a community. I'll give you an example. Right now I'm dealing with issues, trying to help a couple of sisters who are in distress and, you know, going through difficult times. And we do not have any social services, you know, where we can offer them help. Like I told you, there are abused women, for example, battered women. Okay, we have runaway kids who, instead of running away to non-Muslims, for example, or becoming homeless, exposing themselves to dangers, where we can provide, you know, places for them to help them deal with difficult situations that they face. Yesterday, I got a call from the hospital telling me that there is an older Muslim woman who needs an aid, you know, to help her. And she asked me, you know, whether we have any services, rehab services, where we can take sick people or older people, whether we have a facility like that. And I told her no. And she was surprised. She said, well, most of the churches do provide some sort of services like that. So we can talk about that, what we can do as a community, or what we can do in order to plan services and to provide services for our community. طيب الحمد لله, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless, strengthen our faith and the faith of them, protect the new Muslims. Allahumma ameen, Allahumma ameen. They need prayers. We have a South Florida new Muslim group. We usually advise them to join it in order to find people who have similar situations, and, you know, if they want some social support to join that. Ultimately, the best thing for them is to join a masjid and to become a part of the masjid for the new Muslims, to attend the classes in the masjid, to participate in the prayers, to befriend, you know, some of those who go to the masjid. That would be in their benefit, inshallah. Okay, I think we conclude this session today. Inshallah ta'ala, I'll meet with you again next Friday, 8:35, like I told you, because Maghrib prayers right now is 8:20. So instead of 8:30, 8:35. Barakallahu feekum. I thank you very much for being with us today. Jazakumullahu khairan. I will see you inshallah next week. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.